there's looting and fires involved.
Iran and the U.S. are negotiating.
Those weapons ended up in the hands of ISIS.
Been a cover-up artist, really, for a long time.
People armed with sticks, bricks, and other weapons have attacked officers.
Whether or not God created the sun, moon, and stars.
The violence comes on the day of the funeral for Freddie Gray, who died of a spinal cord injury.
After the U.S. supplied those Syrian so-called freedom fighters with weapons.
Loyalty to the Islamic State claimed responsibility for
area businesses. A police cruiser was burned.
Well, welcome tonight. It is so wonderful to be here with you and to open the Word of God together. Do you feel His presence here tonight? Yeah. Amen. Oh, friends, I hope you do feel His presence tonight. He is here, and He is so good, and He is so gracious. Why don't you lean over to your neighbor and say, I feel Jesus. And if they look at you funny, just go ahead and pray for them right now. I mean, just give them some Jesus. They need some Jesus. Hey, I'm Pastor Joseph, and it is my pleasure to welcome you here tonight, and it is so, so good to be with you. Tonight, I want you to get your Bibles and open it up to the book of Revelation, and if you're not really quick with your Bible, it's easy. It's the very last page, okay? Well, there's like concordances and dictionary and maps and stuff, so we're not going to be looking at the maps, but if you have a Bible that is got those things, then you're going to have to flip back a little bit, and you're going to find Revelation. All right, we're going to look at that book tonight. We're going to be studying it over the next few weeks. I haven't really put a cap on this series because there's so much I want to teach you and show you. Tonight, I want to jump in just a moment, but I have to start by saying we love you no matter what. If it's your first time, second time, third time, if you're new with us, we love you no matter what. I don't care what you've done. I don't care where you've been. Christ will receive you. Christ will redeem you. He will make you new, a new creation, and it is absolutely an amazing thing what He does. If you're here tonight for the first time, would you mind slipping up your hand so we can just give you a big round of applause and say, what's up? Welcome, 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 welcome. God bless you, God bless you. Hey, amen, what's up? Welcome, how you doing, man? God bless you, I love it, I love it. So good to be with you tonight, so good to open the Word of God. I rarely anticipate a message as much as when we are talking about the end times or eschatology. If you want to be smart, if you want to like sound smart, it's really the technical term for the study of the end times. Our theology as it pertains to the end times events is called eschatology, okay, if you want to take that down. Now, tonight, I want to give you almost an introductory view of God's timeline. Some people call this different things. There's a word that I would like you to be familiar with. It's called dispensational theology, okay? This will be almost an introductory course into dispensational theology, if you will. How many of you are familiar with that term? Raise your hands, you've heard it before. Okay, this is simply dispensing. That means to be laying out. Imagine if I had like some candies up here or something and I was to dispense them, right? So this is dispensational theology, and it pertains to time. So literally the dispensing of time from God's perspective, how God has laid out time before and even in the beginning of time as He created. And let me write this down. Time is a creation. You are a creation, and so is time. And the creation that we know now will cease to exist, and it will be renewed and made like it was intended to be. Time is something that we are confined by only now, but yet when we enter into eternity, the shackles of time will be broken off of us. Time is a created thing, just like you. Okay, write that down. So let's get into this. We're gonna talk about time. From the beginning, God determined how much time would be allowed for human history. Write that down. From the beginning, God determined how much time would be allowed in human history. Our generation, I believe, will witness a series of imminent, that means they will happen and they will happen soon, prophetic events that will trigger the end of the age. It's not something to fear. In fact, listen, Bible prophecy is a gift from God. In fact, one of the greatest gifts from God is prophecy, as it is opening up the Word of God and showing you what is yet to come. Now, as we get into this, I want to preface by saying this. If you're here and you differ with me on our eschatology, we are still brothers in Christ. I respect you and I honor you, and I would love to talk to you about it. I have incredible friends with incredible knowledge about the Bible that hold different views about the end times events than I do. Guess what? We will see very soon, okay? One way or the other, we're going to heaven. If you have claimed Jesus Christ as your sacrifice, you and I, no matter how the end times events play out, we are destined for the same moment to look into our Creator's eyes as He says, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Is anybody living for that moment? Can I hear a shout? Amen. Before we get into much, I want you to flip to 2 Peter 3, verse 1. As you're turning there, I want to say this. As it relates to the end times, plan your life like you will live for 100 years. Plan your life like you will live for 100 years, but live each day like Jesus is coming. So plan and be smart, be a good steward. Every time I teach on the end times, I have students come up to me and say, "Pastor Joseph, I was planning on attending college." So, attend college. "Pastor Joseph, I was planning on buying a house." Buy a house. "Pastor Joseph, I was thinking about, you know, planning a family and I was gonna have a child. Should I do it?" Absolutely, be fruitful and multiply. This should not change a thing when you live in the confidence of Christ. You should live like Jesus is coming back today, but plan like He's not coming back for 100 years. Be wise, be smart, and be watchful as the end grows near. Let's read together, friends. "Dear friends, this is now my second letter to you. I've written both of them as reminders to stimulate you towards wholesome thinking. I want you to recall the words spoken by the past holy prophets and the command given by the Lord and Savior through the apostles. Above all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, 'Where is this coming He promised? Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as since the beginning of creation.' But they deliberately forget, that's interesting, that long ago, by God's word, the heavens came into being, and the heaven was formed out of water and by water. By these waters, also the world, the present heavens and the earth are, also the world of that time was deluged," that means flooded, "and destroyed." Verse 7. "By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly." There is, listen friends, there is a strange theology going around that there is no hell, we all wind up in heaven, all religions lead to God. Jesus is excluded from that belief because He very assertively and aggressively proclaimed, "I am the only way, the only truth, and the only life, and no one comes to the Father except through Me." There is a judgment for the ungodly. And that is something that we need to let the world know. It's not mean. It's not cruel. It is a fact to say there is a judgment. It's like a child walking next to the deep end and you saying, "Hey, there's a deep end of a pool right there." That's not unkind. Who cares if I offend the kid's parents? If there's a kid like walking, almost gonna fall in, I'm gonna grab the kid. And a parent can be mad at me if they want. I just saved your kid. Sometimes we act like that with people, like, "Oh, I don't wanna offend people. You know what if they get mad?" They're about ready to fall to their death. We have to tell them that there is a punishment coming in the end for those that don't know Jesus. Now, of all times in history, is not a time, friends, for you to be playing in the world, dabbling on the edge of sin. Verse 8, "Do not forget this one thing, dear friends, with the Lord." Now listen, this is important. "A day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like a day." Now this is Peter writing. Peter is the rock on which Jesus said, "I will build my church." He was like the original church leader. So Peter is saying something interesting here. Peter is actually echoing a commonly thought and taught practice here about time. So I want you to highlight it, underline it. "A day is like 1,000 years. The Lord is not slow in keeping His promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, He's patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance." So why is Jesus waiting? He is patient. He's not willing that any should suffer or any should die or any should burn. Jesus desperately wants the world to know Him and to go to heaven. So Why does it seem so long? Because he is patient. And listen, that scripture also gives a warning. Before you scoff at this teaching, know that in the end, scoffers will come. Scoffers will come. Now, I want to lay out a timeline as we see it according to the Bible. Now, we can talk in depth about dinosaurs. We can talk about fossils. We can talk about the age of the earth. And I actually do think that's debatable to a point. Up until the time of Adam, we see Adam in his fall. There is a layout of time from that moment forward that we see. Now, previous to that, there is some debate even amongst the church on what could have happened previous to that time. But through genealogies and through the Bible, it lays out actually an entire genealogy that we can trace back and know the exact number of years to Adam. So I want you to keep that in mind as you think. As you have, many of you have been taught the religion of evolution. Because as we all know, much of the things that we're taught in school are taught much more like it's religious fact than a theory. A lot of people like to throw that off. I will say this. I think that microevolution is undeniable. We see it even in the breeding of dogs and different things. But there is no good scientific theory or method for macroevolution of the crossing of breeds. There's no explanation for that. Well, it's billions of years. Whenever there's like something that doesn't make sense, it's billions of years. Okay, well, I don't care how many billions of years that you let like a rock sit there, it's a rock, okay? I don't care how many, if you put all the elements of life in a box and shake it for a billion years, you're not gonna get me popping out like, hey, I'm Pastor Joseph. No, it doesn't happen. The odds have been calculated by people a lot smarter than me for evolution to be true in the macro sense that has been described to you in your school, not the micro sense that I do agree with, that we can see. There is not enough space nor matter, even if the extent of time existed that they say, for the possibility of life to come into existence. Somebody a lot smarter than me calculated the entire mass of the expanding universe, and the extent of time they say it would have taken, and the odds simply don't match up for a mathematical mind. And that's why, even today, there are thousands upon thousands upon thousands of scientists falling away from the traditional theories that they've been taught. Now, not in the micro sense, but in the macro sense. Understand that. So before you scoff, understand, God's word was, God's word is, and God's word will remain. I own many Bibles. I own a Bible that is called the Archaeological Bible. In this Bible, I love it because as I read it, it has highlights of that time and what's going on and discoveries that have been made. Now, in all of history, in archaeology, the Bible has not been disproven on any one account. Yet there are hundreds upon hundreds upon hundreds of findings that correlate with what the Bible says. The Bible is true. The Bible is accurate. And the Bible will stand the test of time. So, don't forget this one thing. Here we go. We're diving in. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like a day. So God said 1,000 years is a day, and a day is 1,000 years. Is this metaphor, or is this actually something that we see throughout Scripture? Just a couple of pictures for you here. Psalm 90, verse 4. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by. Like a watch in the night. God has a calendar. This is not a teaching that I made up. This is a teaching that we see Peter referencing. This is a teaching that the early church taught. This is a teaching that even the Jewish leaders at the time of the early church were teaching. Rabbis taught this for thousands of years, even now. Isaiah 46, 9 through 10. Remember the former things, those of long ago. I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me. I make known from the beginning, from ancient times, what is still to come, and say, my purpose will stand, and I will do that, what I please. I love that. God's like, I do what I want. If you guys want to know the theological term for God saying, I do what I want, it's called sovereignty. God is sovereign. He operates outside of your realm of understanding. He doesn't need your permission. He doesn't ask for it. He does what he wants. This is like so gangster of God right here. I say my purpose will stand and I will do what I want. That's my translation. do what I want. This is part of the reason why I'm an imminent return theologist. I believe that God could return at any moment. There is nothing withstanding, nothing withholding him from coming back. God does what he wants, and God could come back. Do it now. Right now. That would have been cool. Amos 3:7. Surely the sovereign Lord does nothing without revealing his plan to the prophet, to his servants, the prophets first. So Moses, the prophet of God, was inspired by God to write the Pentateuch, or the Torah. That is the first five books of the Bible. So what are the first five books of the Bible? No, not Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. No, it's the Pentateuch or the Torah. Okay, yes, it is Genesis. Okay, you list the books. But that's the name of it, okay? It's the Torah. And who wrote it? You guys, okay, come on. I don't usually test you in my message, but I just told you who wrote it, okay? Moses wrote it. Ready? Rewind. Who wrote the Torah? Okay, Moses is the prophet of God. He wrote those first five books of our Bible, okay? Moses. Who wrote the first five books?
Moses,
all right? There you go. I'm trying to educate you and inspire you tonight, okay? You need to know some stuff. You need to know where we're going here tonight. So Moses wrote these first five books so that we would not have to live in darkness, all right? He revealed certain things to us and showed us, even in the Old Testament, many people think about the New Testament, specifically Revelation, by the way, not Revelations. It's the revelation of John on the Isle of Patmos. That is the full name of that book. The book is not called Revelations. It is the revelation of John on the Isle of Patmos. Okay, that is the actual name. Don't call it Revelations. I want to show you something else. 1 Thessalonians 5, the day of the Lord. Now, brothers and sisters, about the times and dates, we do not need to write you. For you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying, peace and safety, destruction will come on them suddenly. Pause. He's saying, I don't need to write you about the days or the times because it will come upon them. He's separating two groups. He's talking to the church. You are very well aware that God is coming back. You are very well aware of the signs of his coming. But for those who do not know Jesus, it will come like a thief in the night. We do not have to be ignorant of his coming. We can know the signs as a good farmer sees the clouds and knows that the rain is coming. We should be like the good farmer and be able to see the signs of his coming. So while people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come on them suddenly. As labor pains on a pregnant woman, they will not escape. If you have never been around a pregnant woman, I have three children. What happens is this. You get pregnant. I don't need to tell you how to do that, okay? But we got a mixed crowd tonight. But you get pregnant. 9 months of gestation. That means the baby's growing. And then at the end of that 9 months, the pain starts to come upon the woman. You can say that the pain starts to come upon the woman the moment she met the guy that got her pregnant. But that's a whole nother thing. And then they increase. And there's a sense of anticipation that builds. And of course, the woman and my wife is a little afraid of the pain to come, a little afraid of the turmoil of it all, but the excitement of what's about ready to be birthed is worth the wait and the pain, amen? So the example we're given of the earth being in pregnant state, it's going to become worse and worse and worse on this planet. And pain will increase until finally the birth will come and we will see the new heavens and the new earth. So when we look around and we see the increasing, daily increasing distress upon the earth, I mean, in my lifetime, when I was young, I would have never imagined turning on the news and seeing people getting their heads chopped off on TV. Think about the world we live in. I mean, I was born in 1983. And to some of you, that's old, some of you, that's young. But even thinking back through the 90s, even in the early 2000s, we would have never imagined being able to think of that, let alone see it on TV. You know, just a couple of weeks ago, there was this tragic story of Aleppo in Syria, which, by the way, next week, be here. Russia, Syria, Iran, these are major players, China, mentioned in Bible prophecy, and they are all getting into the exact placement and the exact alignment that the Bible said they would be when Jesus returns. Things are moving on this massive chessboard of the earth beyond any speed that I could have ever imagined. Every time I see a newspaper, I'm reminded of Bible prophecy. God is coming soon. We see in Aleppo in Syria that ISIS went in and they found Christians that had been meeting. They had grown. And there is now hundreds of them meeting in Aleppo in Syria. Converts from the Muslim faith, they became Christians. These ISIS members, these people filled with Satan, filled with the spirit of Satan himself, go into the camp, they drag out the Christians, they drag out this family in particular, and they begin to torture this family for days. They crucify them. You're like, I didn't come to church to get depressed. I have to tell you this. Literally, right now, on the other side of the world, our brothers and our sisters are being tortured to death. And I have people come to me and say, do you think the tribulation is gonna be pre, post, or mid-trib? Do you think Jesus is gonna come? I look at them and say, right now, people are being killed, chopping their heads off, torturing them. Even a child getting his fingers cut off in front of his father. And that child, 12 years old, would not deny Jesus. What kind of revelation must that child have gotten of who Jesus is if he would stand there and say, take my fingers, but do not take my Jesus? 12-year-old boy, as he looks into his father's eyes and his father's weeping for him, this just happened. We are living in the last days. There's coming a moment, and the Bible predicted it, when the whole world will watch as Christians are tortured and beheaded. The megachurch, as we see it in America and throughout the world, I pray that we get to see the growth of this thing and we get to meet together in these beautiful assemblies and we get to hear the hundreds of voices singing like we just did until the last day that I draw my final breath. But something inside of me says that maybe the way that we're doing things won't last as long as we think it will. The pressure is on, the cooker has been turned up, and the time is now. Jesus is coming. Are you ready? Are you living a lukewarm life? Are you living on the edge? Because our brothers and sisters in Syria right now are losing their life. And we just go and play church. Let's not play church anymore. Let's not just play around with this. Let's be passionate. Let's dive in. Brothers and sisters, you are not in darkness, so this day should not surprise you like a thief. That's what that scripture goes on and says. Look around, see the signs of the time. I'm gonna tell you, if you're going to miss Upper Room this year at all, do not miss over the next few weeks, because I will lay out for you some incredible things that you need to know. And especially, listen to me, if you're in here and you're one of those Christians that walks the fence and you play around and you treat Jesus like some trinket, and you're in and out of Upper Room, and you're in and out of Christianity, and you're up and you're down, you need to be here these next few weeks. Because if you're here during the tribulation, you need to know what to look for. I don't want you to go into that time uneducated. If you're here and you're an atheist, or you're a non-believer, or you're a mocker, please, I compel you to stay and listen. I love you so much. I want you to know that there's a day coming when it will be hard, hard, hard for you to live for Christ. Where there might not be any Pastor Josephs or Upper Rooms for you to go to. Where we are confined to the house church like China or Syria or throughout the Middle East. There may come a day for America. I even see it, friends. You can laugh right now. You can scoff right now. You can giggle at me because I know it's been made a big joke. But I tell you, as I look at this election cycle and I see these two ungodly people that we have to choose from, I say, God, are you punishing this country? Is judgment coming upon America? It very may be so. We sure have earned it. There is coming an end to time. I want you to show, I want to show you God's 7,000 year prophetic calendar. And I want to show you in a couple ways. Number one, the 7 days of creation and how they correlate to and parallel each millennium of human history. So the 7 days of creation and the 7 millennium of humanity. Remember this, guys. I want you not to be unaware, all right? Peter said, do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years. 1,000 years is like a day. Remember in Isaiah. Remember throughout the Old Testament. This is something that's quoted over and over and over and over again. So the 7 days of creation, the Jewish calendar, listen, we're going to get a little complex and then I'll explain, has 7 sabbatical years. They were told to let the last rest. This is even a picture of the 7 days of creation. So in the Jewish calendar, we have 7 and then we have a rest. It's called a Sabbath year. We have a rest, like a Sabbath day, a rest day. In Daniel 9, the angel revealed to Daniel 70 sevens of years, or 490 prophetic years, which were declared, and we have only 7 of those years left, those prophetic years. So God counts time in sevens. 7 is a prophetic number to God. 10 is a prophetic number to God. There are certain numbers when you read Bible, you need to understand God is saying something to you when he has certain numbers. 7 is God's number. 6 is man's number. 666 is 3 sixes in opposition to God's perfect Trinity, 3, and God is 7, his perfect 7. We are man, and that's why that mark is 666. We see that? That's interesting to me. What that is mankind saying we will be like God. It's pride. You know what the original sin is? It's pride. You know what the final sin will be? Pride. You know what the hardest thing for me to deal with as a pastor? Pride. I can deal with outright sinfulness because it's obvious for me to recognize and show you. But those of you that become self-righteous and egotistical, especially when it becomes about the word of God, it is so hard for me to lead you because you are so prideful. And I pray for you instead of even trying to approach you. If people stop approaching you, take notice. So how do we know we are at the end of time? Number one, the 7 days of creation prophetically parallel each millennium of human history. Write that down. The first day of creation parallels the 1,000 of human history and the most significant spiritual event of that time. I'll give you a quick rundown. Like I said, this is a flyover dispensational theology 101 class, okay? So number one, on the first day, God created and separated the light and the darkness. The most significant event in the 1,000 years was Adam and Eve sinned, and they fell and they were separated from light. God is light, Satan is darkness, the separation. Day 2, separation of the waters below and the waters above. In the 2,000, God flooded the earth through the flood, the global flood, and saved his chosen through Noah. Number 3, the blessing of plants yielding seeds was the 3rd day, and the 3rd 1,000 of history is the seed of David that was promised to bring about Jesus, who would bless all of the earth, right? So the seed is mentioned, and it is the primary. On the 4th, the light in heaven and the prophets were given, and Jesus, the ultimate light, came, and the light shone in heaven above Bethlehem. So we see the light of the heavens. There's a parallel going on here. Number 5, living creatures were created. Jesus died so that we could become alive. He gave us true life once again. So we see the parallel here once again. On the 6th day, the millennium that we are now living in, man was commanded to fill the earth and subdue it. On the 6th day, fill the earth, subdue it. In the 6th millennium, we filled the earth and finally have subdued it, and we have power over the earth to completely destroy it, even through nuclear means. We have done that. Do you see the parallel here? This is something that's been taught in church history. Peter talked about this. The early church believed this, and you can believe it or you cannot believe it. It doesn't affect your faith at all. Jesus Christ is still on the throne. And number 7 is the 7th day that God rested. There is coming a timeline of events that will lead to the culmination of the church age, which we are now living in. The church age is then directly bookended by the rapture. We see the rapture of the church. We go to heaven. There is a marriage supper of the Lamb that takes place. It's like the greatest marriage ever. And then at the end of the tribulation, we come back with Jesus, and we are riding with him as his saints, clothed in white. And Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So this is the final 7. When Jesus returns to establish his kingdom here on earth, we enter into what's called the millennial reign. That's 1,000 years of rest on the earth, where Jesus rules on earth. So Once again, I want you to have a timeline. We are in the church age. The rapture is imminent, whether that be right at the beginning of the tribulation or at the middle of the tribulation, however you believe that. I really do not personally see any good argument for post-tribulation theology. I just don't see it. It doesn't mean you're bad. It doesn't mean that I don't like you. I just personally don't see any good argument for that. We can talk about pre-tribulation or mid-tribulation, and that's fine with me anyways. So we go to heaven. We are at the marriage supper of the Lamb. During the time that we are in heaven, on earth, it is 3 years of peace, 3.5 to be exact, and 3.5 of the bowl wrath judgments of God poured out on the earth, where there will be massive chaos and destruction like this world has never, ever seen. The Antichrist will come. He will establish his kingdom, a kingdom of peace. The final conquering of this world by the evil one will be conquered by peace and not by war. He'll make peace with the nations. Then he will desecrate God's temple halfway through the tribulation, and that will enter into the most chaotic and miserable time this earth has ever seen. At the end of that, we come back. Jesus conquers by the word of his mouth. He says his eyes are like blazing fires. From his mouth comes a two-edged sword, and he defeats the enemies, and we reign with him for 1,000 years on earth. This is a flyover view of the time of God, the timeline of God. So here's a picture of that final time, Revelation 20. Revelation 20, and I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the keys to the abyss and holding in his hand a great chain. He seized the dragon, the ancient serpent, who is the devil or Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. This is the millennial reign. This is the rest period that we see pictured even in the beginning. He threw him into the abyss and locked and sealed it up over him to keep him from deceiving the nations anymore, until the 1,000 years are ended. After that, he must be set free for a short time. Pause. Why do people go to hell? Because we choose it. In the beginning, it was perfect. We were with God. We walked with him. There was no sickness, no death, no anything that was negative at all. Only perfection. And yet we chose to choose this knowledge. Pride. We chose pride. We wanted to be like God. Kill your decrepit pride, my friends. Don't ever let it come up. Let the seed be crushed inside of you. Never let pride rise. We chose our own way. We ate of that fruit. There will be a picture, just as the end was the beginning, just as the beginning will be the end. Listen, at the end of that 1,000 years, it will be perfect. It'll be like Garden of Eden on earth again. For 1,000 years, the devil is locked in the pit, and at the end of that 1,000 years, after 1,000 years of people seeing how good God is, after 1,000 years of us reigning with him, after 1,000 years of no sickness or pain or no war, after 1,000 years of being able to see Jesus rule, what happens? Something really interesting to me. After that, he must be set free for a short time. I saw the thrones on which were seated those who had been given authority to judge. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony about Jesus and because of the word of God. Pause. We have friends right now, today, listen, who are listed here in this passage in Revelation. Today, Christians lost their head for the faith. Today. Today. Can you pause and get out of your self-centered world for a moment and realize that across the world, in some desert, there's a man or a woman or a child who's facing the sword of a deranged psychopath saying, simply deny this Jesus and turn back to the Muslim faith, and I will spare the sword from your neck. At this moment, around the world, that event is playing out day after day, hour after hour. They will not be forgotten by God. And friends, if you're ever in that moment where someone walks in, even as on our own West Coast here, up in Oregon just last year, a man walked into a college and lined everybody up and said, do you believe in Jesus? Yes? Boom. Killed him. Boom. Killed him. After another. No, I don't believe. Went on to the next one. Boom. How many stories have we heard about in our own nation? What is it about people getting Christians and saying, just deny Jesus, and they kill them? It is this satanic, demonic, evil spirit called Antichrist that stirs people up to do stuff like that. And there is a spirit of Antichrist within ISIS. that is causing violence against the church. But those who have been beheaded and crucified and tortured and shot and mutilated, they will not be forgotten because they are under the throne of God. You know, Peter leaned into Jesus and said, "Can I sit at your right hand?" Jesus said, "You don't know what you're asking." Literally, you are asking to be a martyr. You know who gets to sit at the throne? The martyrs. The martyrs are the ones that get to sit at the throne of God. So he leaned to Peter and said, "You don't know what you're asking. You're asking to be tortured and crucified and killed. This is a high calling. I pray that if you were ever facing that moment, that you have the strength to stand. But I encourage you, before the moment comes, square with your own heart of what you will do." You know, I often talk to people, you know, "How do I stay pure? How do I not fail? How do I not, you know, have sex with my girlfriend?" I said, decide in your heart now what you will and will not do before the moment comes. Decide now. Decide now what you will do for Jesus. Will you stand or will you cower? They had not worshiped the beast nor its image and not received the mark on their foreheads or their hands. They came to life and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. This was the first resurrection. Blessed and holy are those who share in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them, but they will be priests of God and Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. So we know for certain that the final 1,000 years of history has not yet been culminated. After the church is taken away, we will enter a time of tribulation. After the tribulation comes that final 1,000 years. So that's the timeline. That is what's ahead of us. It continues on towards the end of the tribulation, and I want to show you that in Revelation 19 and verse 11. You can turn there, or you can look on what I call the big Bible over here on the screen, okay? Revelation 19. I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider was called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and wages war. His eyes were blazing like fire, and on his head were many crowns. His name was written on him that no one knows but himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. Oh, it's Jesus. You know whose name is the Word of God? Logos. It is Yeshua. It is Jesus. Jesus literally is the Word of God. His name is the Word of God. Isn't that amazing? That beautiful book you hold called the Bible is actually like the breath of Jesus. Oh, it's so good. And the armies of heaven were following him. That's you and me. Riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen and white and clean. Coming out of his mouth was a sharp sword which could strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads on the winepress in the fury and the wrath of the God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has written the name King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I think it's interesting that it says on his robe and on his thigh. To me, that says Jesus has a big old tattoo that says King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Jesus comes back pierced and tatted, amen? You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. I just offended some people, I don't care. Number two. Okay, so that's one way that we can see it. Number two, and tonight I'm teaching you, I'm trying to make you understand, so take notes, and you can email me if you want with questions, or you can Facebook me or whatever, and I will answer you back as quickly as I can, all right, if you want to. If you need help, I want to help you. This is a deep topic. So number two, by counting the calendar years in light of the end times events that are already occurring today. So if this is true, right, if Jesus is coming back, and if we're somewhere in this time, we should be somewhere near the end of that 6,000 years, right? You get it? You understand? If we have 6,000 years of human history from Adam until now, then we should be able to see that. And so let me show you. Number one, our Gregorian solar calendar. We operate on what's called a Gregorian solar calendar. That is the 365-day calendar. It is not as good, actually, as the lunar calendar that the people of God, the Israelites, use. And so I have to translate some things because in our modern calendar, which was created by sun worshipers, by the way, we have some holes and we have some mistakes, and it's not as accurate as an ancient calendar that God's people used. So I'll fix that for you here. So we are in the year 2015, and it's been 2,000 years since Jesus. Thumbs up. Y'all with me? Let me see. 2016, sorry. Good. You guys caught me. We're in 2016. So we agree Jesus came 2016 years ago, okay, right? Thumbs up, you guys with me? Okay, over here, you guys good? All right, I want you to stay with me here. I want you to understand, because we're doing math, and a lot of you guys went to Bakersfield high schools, okay? So I want to help you. Oh, I'm just kidding. My wife's a teacher for BCSD. I'm joking, okay? So here we go. We get in here and we see now, in Luke 15, we are given a genealogy of Jesus. That means, like, I'm Joseph, and I live, say, 60, 70, 80 years, and then my dad is Al Roundtree, and he lives, you know, 80 years, and then his dad was Alfred Roundtree, and he lived 80 years, and so on and so forth. So a genealogy is like, it's like a family tree, okay? You with me? Thumbs up? Okay, we're getting into some good stuff here. So we should be able to see that from Adam, and we actually can see, that there were 4,000 years until the time of Christ. So let's do some intense math here. We can trace back the genealogy that we find in Luke, and it is actually 4,000 years from Adam until Jesus. So 4,000 years until Jesus, and since Jesus, it's been how many years? What is that, all of my math majors? If it's too hard to do the thousands, okay, what is 4 plus 2? Yeah, add the zeros. So we have 4,000 years of the Old Testament plus the 2,000 years since Christ, the church age. That's one way to look at it. That's our solar Gregorian calendar. The next way is this. We can look at the Jewish calendar. The Jewish people have two calendars, the civil calendar, and they also have the religious calendar. During the time of the dissemination of the people of God, there was some breakup of their calendar, and there was some last years that there is some discrepancy on here, all right? So understand there's a little bit of discrepancy in their calendar because they were spread all over the earth. The Jewish year starts on Rosh Hashanah, September 13th for us, okay? So the head of the year, the day when Adam and Eve were created traditionally. The number of any given year is the amount of years which have elapsed since creation. So they don't count it as 2016. They count it from Adam until present. So they have a lunar calendar as God directed, and they don't have AD BC. They just have from time on, from Adam. So there are some that dispute this calendar a little bit, but the calendar of the civil Jewish people, you could look this up, is actually at 5,775 right now. That's really interesting to me. When you see a picture of God's timeline laid out, when you look at the events happening in the world, it tells me we are at the final events of time. So there's also another group of people that studied this calendar, and they looked at it and said, there's actually some holes in this. And it's actually a growing movement within Israel to even change this calendar. And they believe we are actually in the year 6001. And that 6000 actually ended in March of last year in 2015. It's according to them. So don't stop living your life, but understand we are in the final moments of history. Number 3, the prophetic symbols in Scripture. The prophetic symbols in Scripture, we have Noah and his direct connection to the end. Jesus mentioned Noah. He said, it will be like in the days of Noah. Nothing in Scripture is on accident. Luke 17 says, just as in the days of Noah, it will also be in the days of the Son of Man. People were eating and drinking, marrying and giving into marriage up until the day, circle that, then Noah entered the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. The flood is a picture of God's judgment. The ark is a picture of salvation. The ark is a picture of even the rapture, how Noah didn't know what time it was going to be that God would say, get into the ark and it would start raining. This is a picture of the final events. Do you know, nothing in Scripture is on accident. So Jesus drew this direct parallel to Noah and the end, and he even referenced the day in which Noah entered the ark. This is important. Noah lived 950 years. In the pre-flood world, people lived longer. In Genesis 9:29, we see that God could have put Noah at any time in his life onto that ark. Yet he chose, in Genesis 7:6 and 11 through 12, Noah was 600 years old when the floodwaters came upon the earth. In the 600 year of Noah's life, God picks to put him into the ark. This 600th year is a picture and a parallel of the 6,000th year of human history. If Noah lived 950 years. Do you know that Jesus is the ark of salvation? The ark was a type and shadow of Jesus. Are you in Jesus tonight? Are you found inside of him? Number two, Jesus at the wedding of Cana. Jesus's very first miracle is a picture, is a prophetic picture of his coming in the end times. Look with me in John 2, 6 through 11 and Matthew 26, 29. When Jesus was 13, he entered and went into the synagogue to teach, thinking his ministry would begin, but God used his mother to stop him. She took him home, and for 17 more years, then God used his mother to show him the time in which he would begin his ministry. I love this. John 2, 6 through 11. Nearby stood six stone water jugs. So here is Jesus going to do his first miracle. Jesus' first miracle was not done out of his own volition. It was done because his mom told him to do it. Jesus said to his mom, "Don't you know that my time has not yet come?" And she said to the other people, "Just do whatever he says." I think it's so funny that Jesus got pushed into his first miracle by his mom. So if you have any moms that are pushing you towards greatness, just let them, okay? Because even Jesus had a mom, all right? Amen, come on. Thank you for the moms, thank you for the moms. Nearby stood six, circle that, six stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the water with the jars with water so they are filled to the very brim." Then he told them, "Draw the water out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did. The master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned from water into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first and then the cheaper wine after the guests had had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now." What Jesus did here in Cana in Galilee was the first of the signs. Understand, John says it was the first of signs. Circle that, signs. Stay with me, guys. I know this is a little deeper than we usually go, but I want you to stay with me, okay? Don't fade off here. I'm trying to show you something. Signs, signs. Jesus does miracles, Jesus does wonders, and Jesus does signs. A sign points to something, like a stop sign says stop. Or you see a giant arrow. It's a sign trying to show you something. Jesus is showing us something here. It was a sign. It was not a miracle. It was not a wonder. It was a sign. He did it to show you something. If the Bible ever says that it was done as a sign, there is more to it than just the event itself. It is pointing you somewhere. Other times, Jesus did miracles. And it will say, Jesus did a miracle. Other times, it will say, Jesus did a wonder. A wonder is like this. I wonder how he did that. A miracle's like this. It's a miracle. A sign's like this. I'm trying to show you something. Pay attention. It was an object lesson. It was an object lesson. So, Jesus, at the beginning of his ministry, serves amazing wine at a wedding. Good wine. Not just healing the blind. He didn't cast out demons. His first miracle had nothing to do with people getting saved. It had nothing to do with people being healed or demons being cast out. It had everything to do with the unity of a man and a wife. It was a prophetic symbol of his wife to come, the church. The very first miracle Jesus ever did on earth was to create wine for a wedding. You know what his very final miracle will be at the end of the church age? Serving wine at our wedding. Isn't that cool? When we go to heaven, we're at the marriage supper of the Lamb. He says that he gives us the new wine and we feast with him. He was showing us six ceremonial jars of water turned to wine that he scoops from as a picture of prophetic ending. Are you with me, friends? Are you with me tonight? Is this good teaching? Are you guys okay? Do you want a little bit more? All right. So the sign of the bride, the sign of the wedding. In a traditional Jewish wedding, and this is part of the reason I do believe that the rapture happens before the tribulation begins. In a traditional Jewish wedding, we see a mirror of the final events of history where the bridegroom would go to the bride's house He would meet with the parents and arrange a wedding. He would then be promised his bride. He would go and make a place for her. There was not an exact amount of time, but the marriage had been arranged, and the bride was his, and the groom was hers. And the groom would go, and on his father's property, he would go to prepare a place for her. Does it sound like Jesus? He goes to his father's kingdom to prepare a place for us. Now, there would come a moment when that bridegroom was ready, and the family would all get ready, and they would send word ahead like a sign to the family. That family would be told, the bridegroom is coming, get ready, make preparations, it's time for the ceremony. He is ready for you. And the bridegroom would come, and all of his family would come with him, and they would bring a feast, and they would bring all of these amazing like people, and all they would be all dressed up, and the bridegroom would be clothed in white. And he would expect that his bride had prepared herself in white as well. Can you imagine if I, the groom, send my word ahead to my bride and I say, prepare, I'm coming for you. I've spent the last year building you a house. I've made a place for you on my father's property. I'm coming to receive you. And you show up to the wedding in filthy rags? How offended will Christ be when he shows up and his church is standing in rags? Like, I didn't know you were coming. I sent my sign ahead of me. And he draws his bride in and he takes us in. And this is what's amazing. Before we even, this is so beautiful. So the traditional wedding, they would come in and they would have the ceremony, right? He would come like a thief in the night, unexpected. And then they would have this amazing ceremony. They would eat and they would feast. And then, as everyone is still feasting and eating, the bride and the groom would go away and they would consummate the marriage. You understand what I mean? All the adults in here, all right? They would actually become legally married. Do you know that sex is actually a blood covenant bond created for marriage? It's a blood bond, a covenant bond that you make. Sex is actually created as that blood covenant. It's the most sacred of covenants that you make with anybody. And they would go and they would consummate. Then they would come back and the bride and the groom would present themselves to everybody and they would cheer and celebrate. Now, does that sound anything like the picture of the end times events that I just showed you? Isn't that awesome? Isn't that beautiful? Friends, Jesus is coming back soon. Next week, Russia, Syria, Iran, and China. Jesus is coming back. I don't want you to be ignorant. I don't want you to be foolish. Over the next few weeks, I want to show you more proof. I want to take you deeper. I want you to understand. I don't want you to be ignorant, friends. In Matthew 26:29, it says, I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now until the day when I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom. Do you know? Look at me. This is the very last thing I want to say as the band comes. Look at me. Look at me. Matthew 26:29. That is the picture of the final events of Jesus' life on earth. And he breaks the bread and takes the wine. And he says, do this in remembrance of me. Look at me. Many of you didn't realize that was a prophetic event. And he said, I will not eat of this bread or take of this wine until I do it with you in my kingdom. Do you know some of you refuse to fast or give up anything in your life that Jesus has been on a 2016-year fast of bread and wine? He said, I will not take of this again until I take of it with you. He's waiting for the moment to call you home. He is desiring to know you intimately. There is coming the greatest party that's ever been given, and it's a party in my honor and your honor. The party where we take all the honor given to us and we throw it back at Jesus' feet when he places crowns upon our heads. We say, no, the glory and honor is yours. And we eat together and we feast together. And we celebrate. Will you be there? Will you be a part of that final event? Yeah. It's my wedding. It's your wedding. Where we become like him. No, we're not going to be gods, but we will be restored to our beautiful creation. I want to ask you this. Nobody else move right now. I want to ask you just to hold still for one moment if you're walking, because this is the most important moment of my message. I'll just wait 1 second. I just need one moment, just one moment. This is the most important moment of the night. If you don't know Jesus, I want to ask you to receive him tonight. He died for you. He loves you. but you have to receive it. You can't do this by accident. You can't stumble into it. Jesus Christ came because you are a sinner, bound in iniquity, hopeless, beyond repair. You can't do a thing about it. So will you choose Jesus? This is my offering to you. Simple offering. Choose this day whom you will serve. I place before you life and death, blessings and cursing. You want this world? Take it. But Jesus is offering himself up before you now. In this gospel message, I tell you, repent, turn from your evil ways, and choose today whom you will serve. If you've been walking the edge, playing in this world, it's time to get off the ledge and come in to the kingdom of God. If you have been lost in a sea of iniquity and you're not a follower at all, it's time for you to be saved. He's throwing you a lifeline tonight. Take it. Turn from your iniquity. Turn from your evil ways and follow him. I invite you now in front of everybody with every eye open. Everybody look around. Because if you can't acknowledge Jesus in front of Christians, you cannot live it out in front of heathens. I feel like I do you a disservice as your pastor if I say bow your heads and close your eyes and make this a private thing between you and Jesus. Because I promise you there will come a day when it will not be a private matter anymore and you will have to stand for Christ. And maybe someday they come and place the sword on your neck and say, choose today who you will serve. My last breath will be Jesus. Take this life, take this world, but give me Jesus. Is there anybody else tonight? You need Jesus. It's your time. You'll raise your hand right now and say, I need Jesus today. I choose. Put your hand up right now if you need Jesus. Amen. 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 Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Over there in the back, God bless you. God bless you. Anybody else? Anybody else? I see you. I see you. In the back there, I see you, sweetie. I see you ladies right here. I see you. I see some of you. You might have purses. You might even have children with you. What I need from you right now is a moment of your time. I want to make sure you have a Bible. I want to talk to you about the next step called baptism. And I want you to go. There's a sign right there that says, you matter so much. If you raised your hand, I want you to take your purse. I want you to take your wallet. I want you to take your children if they're with you. And I want you to go to that sign right now. Because there's a this moment, you're choosing to walk with Jesus. If you raised your hand all over here, everyone that raised your hand, come on, don't be shy. Don't be shy. Go right now. Go, go, go. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Come on, they're going. Can we? This is awesome. Come on, they're still going. Don't be afraid. If you need to make that choice, go now. Go, go. You matter so much. That sign right there. Come on, come on, come on. There's more. There's more. Don't be shy. Don't be shy. If you need to go, you need to go now. You need to go now. You need to choose today whom you will serve. I place before you life and death. Choose life. Choose life. Choose life. Choose life. Friends, if you're here and you're a Christian, don't be like the church in Revelation that had grown cold. I encourage you, especially if you're here and you say you're a follower of God and you have never been baptized, you need to be baptized tonight. Don't wait, because Christ is coming soon. If you understand that this baptism is death to you and life in Christ, that's all that you need to know. I will baptize you tonight. You don't have to wait. You don't have to go to a class. I will look in your eyes and make sure you understand what you're doing, and then we will baptize you even tonight. Don't wait. Don't put it off. Hey, I feel right now, this is the last thing I'm going to say. I feel so heavy that there's some Christians in here that have not been baptized and you think you're following Jesus. Baptism was not a suggestion, it was a command. If you are a Christian and you are choosing to live in opposition to a commandment of God, you have to question whether or not you are following him. Because you can't follow somebody if you don't follow them. If you're following me to a restaurant after church and I say, okay, follow me, and I turn left and you turn right, are you following me? So if you choose to live in opposition to what Jesus said, are you following him? God bless you, friends.